friend of mine and I were recently looking at a strange apple-like fruit on an unfamiliar plant, and I asked him, "What is it?" And he didn't know, but to my surprise, he picked the fruit and took a bite and then another. He didn't die. In fact, he's here this morning. I've often thought how brave the first tasters of new foods and drinks are. Coffee and beer and raw oysters and sushi and even unsweet chocolate are particular cases in point. You have to develop a taste for them. They are bitter or odd to the tongue or to the eye or to our customs. What is it would be more than a fair question when first partaking of a new and especially odd looking food. I sometimes wonder who the first person was to try this strange food or that strange food after initially asking, "What is it?" Even today, there are some foods that put before us we might not want the answer to that question. What is it sometimes might be better off left unanswered. Here's an example. I read about a so-called bread. I'm not making this up. There is a place in the world where, and I'm quoting, a type of plant lice punctures the fruit of a tree and excretes a substance from its juice in the form of a yellowish white flake or ball. During the warmth of the day, it disintegrates but congeals when cold. It has a sweet taste, rich in carbohydrates and sugar. It is still gathered by natives who bake it into a kind of bread. The food decays quickly and attracts ants. Well, I feel pretty confident that if any of us were shown that flaky stuff on the ground, we'd ask, "What is it?" And if we were told we were supposed to make bread out of it and eat it every day, we'd do a double take and ask a bit more emphatically, "What is it?" And if we knew the answer was plant lice dung, we'd most likely wish we didn't know. In our lesson today, the Hebrew people asked that question about the daily bread God sends them. They asked, "What is it?" And guess what? In Hebrew, the question is pronounced manu, which is where the word manna comes from. And so the food that the people of God get from God, they end up naming, "What is it?" Which is meant to be humorous. And we might find it a little funnier when we know that the plant lice droppings used for food that I described a moment ago are found in the place where the Hebrews were wandering in the wilderness and first asked, "What is it?" And today, natives call the bread they make out of it manna. Since this modern manna corresponds with the details and geography described in Exodus, scholars suggest that it may be the manna referred to, the daily bread from heaven that the Hebrews are reported to have survived on in the wilderness. And that would sure explain why they say, "What is it?" when Aaron and Moses tell them it's to be eaten every day. And I was putting together this sermon, I kept smiling at the idea that probably the most famous food in the Bible, if not the world, manna, translated means, "What is it?" That's funny all on its own. But I also find it funny because I cannot help but wonder what we all think of a modern bread product wrapped up and labeled and marketed for sale by that name. What is it? Builds body 12 strong ways. How? Well, let's look at the list of ingredients. Oh, I see here listed first. Plant lice dung. I'm making a bit light of it, but I'm also trying to impress on us how difficult eating something called "What is it?" manna was for the Hebrew congregation. This was no easy thing. See, while they get the luxury of quail at night, which are also known to come in the areas described in the Bible, every morning they must also wake up to eating this new, very, very different food. And that's the story anyway. You see, all of what the Bible reported in the commentaries and my reports so far may or may not be historically how things happen. People argue about it. Some argue it was a miracle. Some argue it happened because that's food was in the area. Some argue that it's just a story, a poem, like a metaphor. But any way you look at it, we need to consider how the story can have meaning, meaning for us today. And there can be powerful metaphoric truth in the story one way or another. People of God turn from bondage, and the way things were in Egypt with a powerful human elite suppressive way of doing things. And the story remembers that it was God who led them to that freedom and that turning. And so for sure we can understand the story includes a meaning that God rescues people from oppression. And that as a part of those rescues, God provides. It's a common truth set out in many Bible stories. But, and this is always true too, God's people have to turn to the difficult and the strange ways of the wilderness path that God calls them to in order to be fully rescued and transformed from what has been to what should be. In the story, that's happening. God's people are transforming from the old way of doing things. And as we heard, the people complain about it to their leaders. For millennia, people have resisted change. And the leaders, in this case, are right to respond, as we hear Moses and Aaron do, that the complaints are against God. You can hear all of this as metaphor applicable today to our spiritual journeys, turning from the bondage and the oppressive ways of man to the freedom and justice-oriented way of God and Jesus. And it holds up as symbolism for the taking in of spiritual nourishment too. When we turn to God and go on to God's way in the wilderness, we get this wonderful, meaty stuff of unconditional love for us as individuals. Who doesn't like to go to sleep full of that delicious meat, knowing we matter much? That is something we desire and we gladly and want to swallow. But there's a corresponding manna of unconditional for love for others that God's people also have to ingest. When love is unconditional from God, that necessarily means everyone is entitled to that love. And that manna can be hard to swallow. In God's way, as God's people, we have to provide love to everyone, inside and outside the church. And this is a fragile, easy to spoil, some say flaky stuff, this manna of loving others. But like it or not, the manna of unconditional love for others is as essential to our nourishment as the meat of unconditional love is. Hear how that metaphor works. We're supposed to turn away from things that keep us in bondage and the sinful ways that our power elites and the culture call us to do, like the religious and secular pharaohs who even today, after all these years, would still have us not love and oppress those they deem others. Only the bold, only the brave turn away from pharaohs and toward God's love. Because while God's way provides a wonderful meaning, unconditional love for us, God's way also provides a corresponding manna of unconditional love for others that we have to ingest for a balanced spiritual nutrition. To sum that second part, that manna sounds icky. The complete healthy spiritual nourishment, the foodstuffs of our faith, are made of things some don't want to partake of. Because while love for us is easy to swallow, love for others is very hard for some to swallow. Some even treat love for others like it is plant lice done Sadly, I hear it from those outside the church who don't want to turn toward God's way in the world, and who want to continue the power elite sinful way of being unloving to others like LGBTQ, people of color, people of other faiths, even women and the poor and aliens and the disabled among us. It's a sign of not wanting to take in the manna of unconditional love for others. And sadly, over the years, I also hear unloving acts by some inside churches toward members and leaders that they disagree with. There is inherently nothing wrong with thoughtful dissent and disagreement. I encourage it, part of it. But it is sinful to act unkind and unjust and unloving in churches as much as it is to act that way outside. It's also a sign of not wanting to take in the manna of unconditional love for others. I'm sure we've all heard complainers among God's people, not unlike those in the story that Moses and Aaron had to listen to. Going further, outside and inside church. And outside or inside, big or small, the issue is usually the same. The complainers want the good stuff, the meaty, unconditional love for themselves, but they don't want the hard to swallow stuff, easily spoil unconditional love for others. It's hard to desire the well-being of all others, let alone actually provide that well-being. It's easier to be unkind or unjust or unloving. And I hear from time to time that our church, this amazing, welcoming place, is actually exclusive by its inclusivity. Our taking in the manna of unconditional love is somehow conditioned. The argument seems to be that kindness, justice, and love for everyone excludes those who don't want to provide it. In other words, if I have this argument straight, it is exclusive to not allow unjust to act unjustly, the unkind to act unkindly, the unloving to act unloving. And if that sounds confusing, that's because it is a nonsense argument. No one is excluded. Unloving conduct is challenged and excluded. And those who make the arguments, if you think about it, want done to them what they don't want to do to others. They want the meat of unconditional love for themselves, but not the manna of unconditional love for others. They have trouble swallowing the distasteful to them manna of doing to others as they want done to themselves, of desiring the well-being of others and actually acting on it. It's distasteful to many to follow God's commands to love everyone, to action. And really tend to the well-being of all manner of people as God made them, whether we like them or disagree with them, or they are strangers to us or not. We actually and truly welcome all manner of people as God made them. There are boundaries that keep us in line, aimed at the well-being of others, outside and inside churches. We can see this happen. Godly ideals we teach and preach and try to do regarding being respectful to others. We welcome as equals people of all colors and genders and ages and disability and education and wealth and gender identification and partner preference. We welcome as equals those of other faiths and those of no faith at all. We welcome as equal those who are uneducated and those who are educated. Even those who went to college in Michigan. You can be from another church, or be fundamentalist, or an atheist, or an agnostic, or a longtime UCCer, and you will be embraced and treated as equal here. You can disagree with anyone in the church, and you will be welcome. You see, no person is unwelcome, but unkind, unjust, unloving conduct is. How can we be a safe place otherwise? All of this can be hard for some to swallow, and so we hear complaints about that manna of unconditional love in letters to the editor, or to me, or to the leadership, or maybe to you. And you know what? It's fair to answer such complaints by claiming, as Moses and Aaron knew, that your complaining is not against us, but against the Lord. We are doing God's work by trying to take in unconditional love and give out unconditional love. And how do we know It's God's work. Because look on the wall behind you. Micah tells us there are only three requirements God has for humans. And as a whole, we're doing them by caring for the rest and being respectful and safe in this place. We take in the manna, the what is, by aiming as best we can to love kindness and seek justice and walk humbly with God. That's the manna we have learned and continue to learn to swallow and digest. And conversely, those who do not provide kindness are not doing this. Those who do not provide justice are not doing this. Nor is unkindness or injustice or unlovingness humbly walking with our God. And it's not just Micah. In Scripture, we're told God is love, and we're told that love is steadfast and endures forever. We're told to love everyone, all our Christian brothers and sisters, all our neighbors, all of our enemies. And we are told what love looks like. In 1 Corinthians 13, love is patient. Love is kind. Love is not envious or boastful or arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It is not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in truth. It bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. We are trying to be that love unconditionally. We can have unconditional love. Now we can still have conditions for conduct like those from Micah and 1 Corinthians. Unconditional love does not mean rules, courtesies, and expectations for kind, just, and loving conduct go out the door, or that we do not challenge unloving behavior. We cannot have a safe world or safe churches if they are not safe places for Micah. We know that loving kindness includes expecting kindness. Seeking justice means expecting justice. Walking humbly with God means expecting humble walkers with God. And first, from 1 Corinthians 13, we know love's boundaries expect God's people to be patient and kind, to not act envious or boastful or arrogant or rude, to not insist on their own way or be irritable or resentful or rejoice in wrongdoing. These are not elitist expectations because they apply to everyone. They are not exclusionary practice towards how people are made by God, but toward conduct that is unloving and ungodly by biblical definition. And this applies to big issues like oppression in the culture imposed on groups like LGBTQ or people of color or women or those of other faiths or aliens or the disabled or the poor. And it applies to everyday conduct among Christian brothers and sisters. We swallow the manna of unconditional love for those in culture and maybe we have otherwise in the past. But unconditional, all this caring, is not just for people the culture oppresses and those outside churches. Christians are also expected to provide that love to one another, to be respectful to others in all things they do as church or in churches. Calling someone who disagrees with you a so-called Christian, like I saw in a letter to the editor this week, is not doing this, nor is being otherwise unjust, unkind, unloving, or unhumble to anyone outside the church or inside a church. It's not exclusionary to have boundaries that expect kindness, justice, and love. It's not exclusionary if someone chooses to leave because of those boundaries. See, for Jesus' followers, the manna of unconditional love includes swallowing the difficult biblical ideals that we are to love kindness and seek justice and walk humbly and be patient and kind, not act envious or boastful or arrogant or rude, not insist on our own way, or be irritable or resentful or rejoice in wrongdoing. The Christians are to strive to do this both outside and inside churches. And none of us does it perfect. Certainly not all the time. We should try to do so as best we can and challenge one another inside and outside the church to do so. May we all do our part to digest not just the meaty, unconditional love for self, but the manna of unconditional love for everyone. For everyone.